Previously on Harmony and Chaos. Following the defeat of Darkswirl, many new faces have made their appearance in Equestria, with the arrival of Chaotix and Hunter the Hedgehog. However, Hunter's arrival wasn't met with a warm reception, as Shadow revealed there is less than friendly relations between himself and Hunter. However, there was no time for Shadow to confront his rival from the past, as he and Starlight entered a portal 7 years into the past in an attempt to bring down Aeon. Upon arriving 7 years into the past, Shadow quickly realized that he may have bitten off more than he could chew, as an insult to Derpy over her muffins caused the mild-tempered pony to go into a fit of rage. Starlight would warn Shadow he needs to be more careful, and also about keeping a low profile and making it a priority not to make acquaintance with their friends, as the results could have drastic consequences. What challenges will Shadow and Starlight encounter in the past? And will they be able to track down Aeon and prevent him from absorbing Will's powers and becoming the God of Power? Our adventure continues today on Harmony and Chaos. Episode 92, Flirting with Disaster. Seven years in the past, Canterlot, Sunset Shimmer's house.
All right. I don't know who or what the hell you are, but if my mother is the reason you're here, it can't be good.
Aeon gently places his hand on Sunset's face.
Don't touch me!
Sunset, my love, please come and have a seat.
Your love? I don't even know you.
Please have a seat, my dear, because what I'm about to tell you is going to shake you to your core. My name is Aeon the Hedgehog, and I've come from 7 years in the future to reunite with you.
What? Again, I don't know you, and you said my mother Celetta is the reason you're here?
Sunset, we are lovers in my timeline. Or should I be saying we were lovers until you were killed in battle by your mother Celetta? I know this must shock you, but you have to believe me. I traveled back in time just to have this chance at seeing you again.
Okay. I'm freaking out right now. You need to explain everything to me, including how you were able to travel through time and how I died.
A few days ago, you died in my timeline by sacrificing your own life to save Princess Twilight Sparkles.
I would never save that bitch after what she did to me.
I know the history about how you two were rivals over becoming Princess Celestia's apprentice. And you're probably preparing yourself for exile into the Mirror Realm to escape your mother Celetta from forcing you to do her bidding. Am I correct?
How do you know so much?
I know you're a different pony than the Sunset Shimmer I was in love with. But trust me, Sunset, we were madly in love. I know everything about you because of it.
Why would I sacrifice myself for Twilight?
For the most part, you sacrificed yourself out of guilt for betraying Princess Twilight. You were her pupil in the timeline I come from. You and I had a plan to take over Equestria and rule it for ourselves, but in order to do that, we had to join forces with your mother Celetta and Darkswirl. During the fight, you were compelled to help Twilight, throwing yourself in front of your mother's fire wave. I watched on in horror and was completely helpless to save you.
So, Twilight became a princess after all. I knew there was more to becoming Princess Celestia's apprentice than met the eye. I just can't ever picture befriending her.
You had a change in heart, in large part due to your friend Starlight Glimmer's urging. She was also forever changed by Twilight as well. My experience with Twilight has also been a positive one, and I mean no ill will towards her. In my time, she's incredibly powerful, a great leader, and is the Princess of Friendship.
Well, Twilight has always been powerful. But the Princess of Friendship? Twilight can barely carry on a normal conversation without being awkward, and she certainly is not good with friendship. I have so many questions, like, how did we meet in your time, and what was the plan you had with the me of your time?
We met inside the time loophole that exists in this world. Much like the you of my time, you used the mirror portal to escape from your mother's diabolical and oppressive hold she has over you. Many years ago, I traveled to this world in search of a great power, known as the Triad of Power.
The Triad of Power? But that's just a myth.
I can assure you, my dear Sunset, that the Triad of Power is definitely real. And it's yet another reason I've come here, but I'll explain more about that later. As I was saying, I traveled to this world by opening a portal with the magic crystal that is hanging around my neck. It was a freak occurrence, but on the night I arrived to this world, in my time, was also the same night of the 30th moon, so I wound up being dragged into the loophole and into the human realm of this world. We met after the you of my time came through the mirror portal. At first, you were a trespasser on my property, and you became my prisoner. However, you and I began developing feelings for one another. You told me about your dark history with Princess Celestia and Twilight, and that you were wanting to change. For a while, you even convinced me to change as well, Sunset. All I'm asking from you is a chance to win your heart, like I did in my time. What do you say, Sunset? Are you willing to give me a chance?
While I do believe your story about us, I can't. I just can't. Your timing couldn't be any worse. My mother would kill you if you were to get involved with me.
I do not fear your mother, Saleta Sunset. I've already absorbed 2/3 of the Triad of Power into my crystal. If she were to try to harm either of us, I would obliterate her in seconds. I promise on my life you'll be safe with me. All you have to do is trust me.
I can't explain why, but I instinctively know I can trust you. I don't know what's happening here. I've only met you 5 minutes ago. This is crazy.
It's not crazy for me. I know I lost the you of my time that I fell in love with, but trust me when I say the two of you, though different, are still so much alike.
You said the me of your time died a few days ago. Haven't you even grieved my death?
I've dealt with a lifetime of watching those around me I care about die. Grieving is an emotion lost on the weak. The only thing that matters in protecting what or who you love is power. That's the other reason I've come here. I'm 2/3 of the way to gaining a power of a god, and in this timeline, there is no one who can stop me. The only thing left, Sunset, is for me to absorb the powers of Will Atkinson, and the Triad of Power will be complete.
And what made you think that I would willingly go along with you on this plan? I may not be perfect, but I truly am trying to turn over a new leaf here.
Exactly what my Sunset said not too long ago. When I gain this power, I will become the most powerful being in existence, along any timeline. I will never watch someone I love die again. Together, you and I could rule over the entire universe. All evil will be wiped out. I know I can't force you to love me. All I'm asking for is a chance to win your heart all over again. Do you trust me, Sunset?
Yes. I'm not sure where, why, but I want to take this chance with you. Every instinct I have is telling me to do so.
Rarities Boutique, the present day timeline.
Verity and Cap are working together in the war room.
Fluttershy still hasn't shown up. I'm worried about her, Kappa. The poor girl hasn't been the same since Tails broke her heart.
Well, maybe you should go over to her place and check in on her. We're pretty far ahead on all our orders for the gala. I'm sure I could hold down the fort for a few hours.
I probably should. I'll check in on her after we close the boutique for the day. I still have to get all the deliveries ready for Chris when he returns tomorrow. There was something I wanted to ask you, though, Kappa.
Oh, and what might that be?
I was invited to an album release party Saturday night at Town Hall, and I'm allowed one guest. I was wondering if you would like to be my date for the evening.
I would be honored. We'll have a great time.
Cream enters the boutique.
Hello, Rarity.
Rarity, hearing Cream, exits from the war room.
Good morning, Cream. Kappa, there's someone I'd like you to meet.
Rarity and Kappa come out to greet Cream.
Kappa, this is Cream. She was the friend I told you about that was coming aboard to help us out with a gala.
It's nice to meet you, Kappa.
Likewise. Rarity has indeed filled me in on your talents and your history with this place. I look forward to working with you.
I'm just excited to be back and doing fashion again, even if it's only for a short amount of time. So let's see where we are at, shall we?
Right this way, darling. Oh, and you brought the eclairs and the coffee from the cafe. Oh, how I've missed you, Cream.
It's been a while, so figured I'd surprise you with them.
Enter the war room.
I'm happy to report that we are far ahead of schedule on this year's gala. Mainly because of all the extra help I've been able to hire, and having Chris has been a huge help.
Yeah, I definitely can see the difference from this year to last year. Oh, are those the girls' dresses?
Cream referring to a specific rack that has unique designing compared to the other gala dresses.
Yes, those are all the girls' dresses. I'm very fortunate to have Kappa aboard this year, as he's handling all the tuxedo orders for this year's gala. I'm probably going to have you assist him as well as creating the headdresses that ponies have ordered with their dresses. You are all the best when it comes down to the headdresses, Cream.
Cream smiles brightly.
Thank you, Rarity. The headdresses were my favorite part of designing from last year's gala.
Well, I'll allow you two to get started on the tuxedos while I'll start packaging up the deliveries for the Catalan and Manhattan stores. It's wonderful to have you back again, Cream.
I'm happy to be back.
Rarity exits the war room. So, Rarity said that you were her personal assistant.
Yeah, I was. It was right here in this room. This was the room I was in when the changelings attacked and blew up the original boutique.
I'm sorry that happened to you. It must be weird being back in the room in which you died in.
It is, but it's more the memories of it hitting me all of a sudden. I remember Spike rushing in during my final moments of life, and I can't help but feel sad. The truth is, I want to be with him again so badly, but I know it wouldn't be right. I'm sorry. We should be working, and I shouldn't be talking to you about this.
Oh, it's quite all right, my dear.
No, it's not all right. I'm supposed to be helping. Spike it over me, and yet I'm the one who's having an issue. Anyways, changing the subject. You've done an amazing job on these tuxedos. Are they your design?
A couple couple of them are. I had to do some tweaking of my original design so they could fit the figure of a stallion. But working for Rarity has definitely allowed me to showcase my creative side when it comes to fashion.
Well, your work is fantastic, and I especially like the design on this one.
Glad you like it, Cream. That tux is mine for the gala. Right now, I'm in the process of creating the Mobian's tuxes. I've already finished Shadow and Mannix. Those were quite the challenge as well, because I've never had to create formal wear that included making holes in the material for quills.
And I always thought the biggest challenge was getting the boys to wear the tuxedos. In my case, working on the formal wear for the gala is a much-needed distraction.
Meanwhile, chaotic spaceship, just outside Manhattan.
All right, Manic, we're about to head out of here. Are you sure about staying here for a few days?
Yeah, I am. I really want to get a feel for the city and look around a bit more.
You know, Manic, if you're serious about wanting to stay near the city, you could just move into our place aboard our ship if you want.
Are you serious, Vector?
Completely. I mean, it's not like it's going anywhere anytime soon. And having you around to keep the place safe might be a good idea. We have a lot of high-tech investigator stuff aboard our ship. I'm just worried someone may steal it if they think the ship has been abandoned.
Oh my gosh, kid. This is totally awesome. I really appreciate this offer, Vector. And you won't have to worry about anyone breaking into your ship and stealing your stuff. I promise, I'll watch over this place like a hawk.
Well, okay. Here's the keys. This one unlocks the house. Please take care of the place while we're gone.
Yeah, this ship is super sentimental to us and stuff, and don't you even think of dipping into my stash of honey.
That's a worry, bro. I don't even like honey, so no worries on that front.
And here I thought you'd be more worried about the other stash you have in your room, Charmy. Charmy blushing.
I don't know what you're referring to, SBO.
Well, we better be on our way, guys.
I really need to get back to Ponyville and catch up with Rarity. It's been a few days, and I need to get back to work.
Well, let's go, guys. It's time to check out Ponyville and reunite with the gang.
It's a cool place. You guys should have a good time there. Thanks for helping me out, Chris, and giving me a ride here. And Chaotix, thanks again for letting me crash here. Again, I promise to take great care of the place while you're gone.
You're welcome, Manic. It's the least I can do to help a friend. I guess we'll see you back in Ponyville in a few days.
Oh yeah, and you better be prepared to rock.
Well, this is going to be a treat from what I've heard. I missed your band's first performance, so I'm really looking forward to seeing you play, Manic. Anyway, let's head out, you guys.
Chris and Chaotix board the X-Tornado and take off for Ponyville.
Meanwhile, Nightshade flying with Hunter on his back.
How are you holding up back there, Hunter?
I'm doing fine, Senpai. What are we heading off to this morning?
We're making a pit stop to Canterlot. I want to inform Princess Luna of my return to Europony.
So I take it you really enjoy her company, Senpai? Perhaps maybe your special some pony?
Don't be ridiculous, Hunter. I mean, I do like her. However, I'm simply being cordial by telling her where to find me. It would be incredibly rude of me to just disappear on her like that.
You know, she could easily find you in the dream realm while you're sleeping.
Always a smartass, aren't you?
I'm merely just adept at sensing certain things. I think you just want a reason to see her, that's all.
Yes, of course I do. I may have my heart set on Starlight, but there's definitely an interest with Princess Luna. We share a similar past when it comes to having a dark side, much the same as I do with Starlight. But Luna has this presence about her that's difficult for me to ignore.
Well, love is something out of my realm of logical reasoning. Mainly because I never experienced it for myself. I guess you could call it a programming defect.
Your creator may have programmed you to live your life to suit his needs. However, you've managed to escape his vile hold over you and create a life for yourself without him. You're a good guy, Sunny D. This much I know for certain.
Sunny D? Senpai?
Yes, that's my nickname for you, since your fur and quill color reminds me of that drink. For some reason, I like giving your kind nicknames.
I see. Well, I've been called worse by my creator. Actually, I think the nickname is rather funny. And thanks for the kind words.
There's no reason to thank me. I was only being honest, my friend. Anyway, hold on tight. We're landing. Nightshade and Hunter land at Canterlot Castle.
So this is Canterlot Castle? I must say, the story's not doing this place enough justice. This place is huge.
It has to be. The castle just doesn't serve as a home. Many ponies work and aid Princess Celestia in the day-to-day operation. On the whole planet from there.
I've always been fascinated with how things work politically on the planet. Up until recently, Princess Celestia had rule over the entire planet, and yet it was still somewhat of a democracy.
Ruling over an entire planet is a difficult task, Hunter. Princess Celestia needed help in that regard, so each province had its own sub-ruler, or in Europony's case, a prime minister to help in the province's issues. Hunter, looking at the guards.
Do you think they'll let us in?
I didn't think about that part. I wonder if I'm on the pardoned guest list. There's only one way to find out, I guess. Nightshade and Hunter walk up to the guards. Good morrow to you, my fine castle guards. I was wondering if I may seek an audience with Princess Luna. Guard looks at the list, who are allowed access into camp. What is your name, sir? Nightshade, and I am the interim ruler of Europony, and my friend Hunter here is my grand advisor. Let's see here. Nightshade. Ah, yes, here we are. Nightshade, indeed. Princess Celestia has you on the list as the interim ruler of Europony. Moving forward, Your Highness, you must provide a credential to enter the castle grounds, and your friend as well.
I understand, and thank you for allowing us in.
Guards open castle gates and allow Nightshade and Hunter to enter.
You know, we could have flown up to Princess Luna's balcony to avoid the guards. Or worst case scenario, I could have used my mind control ability on him to let us pass.
Mind control ability?
I'm not too keen on using that ability. Using that ability makes me feel a lot like my creator. It's not right to take away another being's self-thoughts of free will. I've honestly avoided using it at all. With a few exceptions, that is.
You better not even consider using that technique on me, Hunter, or else!
Not to worry, Master Nightshade. The technique only works on the weak-minded, which is clearly something you're not.
Good. And as far as flying up to her balcony goes, that wouldn't work, because I would be shot down by the unicorn guards.
My apologies, Nightshade. I forgot about your powers being gone.
Patience, my friend. In due time. I'm certain I will have my powers back. Nightshade and Hunter enter Canterlot Castle and find Princess Luna having breakfast with her sister Celestia.
Oh, Nightshade, Hunter. Good morning. It's nice to see you both.
I wanted to inform you that I will be temporarily co-ruling Europony, as I've agreed to take Prince William's place in his exiled absence.
Yes, Tia has informed me that during breakfast you had accepted Prince William's offer. I guess congratulations are in order. But why did you feel the need to inform me of your decision?
Well, I thought it would be in good manners to inform you of my whereabouts. You know, just in case perhaps you wanted to see me.
I think I'll take my leave for my breakfast, Lulu.
I will do the same as well, Senpai.
Princess Celestia and Hunter walk out of the dining room to give Princess Luna and Nightshade their privacy.
This was a very sweet gesture, Nightshade. I appreciate you coming by to inform me yourself, but I am aware of your true feelings for Starlight Glimmer.
I may have feelings for Starlight, but I can assure you that she does not reciprocate the same for me. I have only recently began becoming acquainted. I would certainly like to continue to explore where our relations go.
As would I. However, Nightshade, courting me, so to speak, won't be an easy task, as I am the overseer of the Dream Realm. It's quite the tedious job, but essential to harmony being maintained across the entire planet.
I am well aware of the strenuous day-to-day, or in your case, night-to-night, that your royal duties put upon you. All I'm requesting is that you give us a chance to get to know one another more before we decide if we're going to pursue a relationship or not.
Well, you're certainly handsome, and I'm incredibly intrigued by you. However, I do not wish to waste my time if your heart belongs to another.
I promise you, Princess of the Night, that if my heart cannot be claimed by you, then you will be the first to know. I have too much respect for you to string you along like that. Meanwhile, Princess Celestia and Hunter have walked down to her private chamber.
So, Hunter, do you mind answering some questions that I have for you? We really didn't have a chance to talk at Twilight's Castle yesterday.
No, Your Majesty. I'm an open book. You're free to ask anything you want to know about me.
How long have you been on our planet?
I would say just over 3 equestrian calendar years, Your Majesty.
How did you arrive here, and what was your reasoning for traveling to this world?
Simply put, Your Majesty, I was finished being an evil pawn in my creator's planetary conquering schemes. So I went and visited with Knuckles the Echidna, and requested that I use my abilities of manipulating chaos energy to teleport to this world. In order to do so, I needed to be able to draw the energy out of at least one of the chaos emeralds. Luckily, Knuckles obliged and allowed me to do so, and that's basically it on how and why I traveled here.
We are aware of Dr. Eggman and the threat he poses once he arrives here. I need to know, is there any chance that he can regain control of your mind and turn you against us?
I highly doubt that he can, considering I removed my microchip several years ago before arriving here. I'm almost positive that Eggman believes I'm dead.
Yesterday, when we met, I couldn't help but notice the tension between yourself and Shadow. When you two reunited, clearly he felt he left you for dead. Care to explain what that tension is between you two?
To say my relationship with Shadow is unstable is an understatement. Despite my programming, I always tried to befriend Shadow, but he didn't see it that way. Shadow was created by Eggman's grandfather, Dr. Gerald Robotnik. A terrible tragedy occurred on the space colony Ark that took the lives of Shadow's creator and his closest friend, Maria. Once Shadow was captured, he was sedated and put in a preservation chamber for over 50 years. During their time on Earth, Eggman would find out about Shadow and released him back into the living world. And Shadow felt obligated in serving him as a debt. Eggman, of course, accepted Shadow because of his uncanny power. But secretly, Eggman was infuriated that his grandfather could create such a being, that he wanted to create one who was better and more powerful. And that's when I come into the story. I was created by the Master Emerald. When Eggman had possession of it briefly, he used its power to turn his thoughts into power. And those thoughts is where I was created. Eggman created me to be a more powerful version of Shadow, a more obedient version of Shadow. In addition to this, he was also my programming to challenge Shadow, and to push him to reach new heights in power.
Well, that certainly explains why there's tension between the two of you. And you said you came to Equestria 3 years ago to escape from Eggman?
Yes, Your Majesty. To make a long story short, I nearly died protecting Eggman from Shadow's wrath. Shadow was enraged at Sawlight's disappearance from Mobius. Thinking Eggman had killed her, Shadow exploded with a rage we had never seen in him before. Shadow had transformed into his dark form, and I was beaten within an inch of my life. I'm honestly not sure what prevented Shadow from killing me, but that was the last time I saw Shadow. Shortly thereafter, I recovered thanks to Sonic fighting me and nursing me back to health. I was being shot, and Sonic asked why he would help me. Sonic being Sonic, and he said he couldn't leave me laying there. He convinced me to leave Dr. Eggman, and said that he was only using me as a pawn, and didn't care about my well-being at all. At this point, Sonic and I had already formed a secret friendship, and I was beginning to put the pieces together on my own, that my creator had only created me to be his pawn. Sonic made me realize I nearly sacrificed my own life for someone who never truly cared about me. So in that moment, I decided to leave Eggman for good. What I hadn't realized was that I had a tracking device implanted in me, and one day, Eggman tracked me down. I was violently attacked by Eggman and his robots. I was holding my own until an energy beam impaled me through the back. After I recovered, I decided it would be in my best interest to leave Mobius. And that's when I went to Knuckles and requested to use the energy from the Chaos Emerald to teleport here.
I am so sorry you had to endure such a tough life.
It's alright. It all seemed to work out in the end.
Meanwhile, 7 years in the past. Vancouver. Shadow and Starlight land from flight. Well, here we are. Do you need a rest after carrying me for so long?
No, I'm fine. You know, we never really came up with a plan for making our acquaintance with Will. I highly doubt we'll be able to just walk up to him.
Yeah, I kind of forgot about that part. I guess we can figure it out once we get to the theater. I'm hoping I can use the I'm his girlfriend line to get in. Regardless, I think I should handle that part alone. The ponies are already giving you weird looks, and it will be much the same once we arrive at the theater.
I don't give a damn what kind of looks I'm receiving, because I'm a hedgehog. I'm going with you to the theater. End of conversation. And we're not going to beat around the bush with the details either. We're not here as fans of Will. We're here to protect Equestria, and that's how we're going to make Will's acquaintance.
Okay, and what if that plan doesn't work? What then? Are you going to use brute force?
I will do what I must to ensure Equestria's safety and bring Aeon down. I hope I'm able to convince him to end the charade of his peacefully.
I hope that as well. I know what Aeon is going through, and from what I've seen when I'm around him, he seems to be conflicted with his emotions. He's had a rough life watching everyone he's ever cared about die in the hands of Eclipse the Darkling. It's pretty to understand why he craves power.
Craving power is one thing. Using it to take over a planet is another. Though we've both been on good terms with Aeon, it's important to remember it could have been an act to get us to lower our guards. None of us have possibly seen the real Aeon or what he's truly capable of.
Well, the theater is only a few blocks away. Do you mind stopping for lunch?
Stop stalling, Starlight! Will won't recognize you anyway, so there's nothing for you to be nervous about. I suggest we be as honest as possible about the situation. But if you seriously want lunch, we can do it after we've talked to Will. Deal?
It's a deal, Shadow. Thanks for keeping me level-headed.
What are friends for, right?
Shadow gives Starlight a friendly hug. Meanwhile, Canterlot, Sunshed Shimmer's house.
Are you sure you want to accompany me? I still feel like you're questioning everything we've talked about so far. And I myself worry how this may turn out, and I don't want anything bad happening to you.
I'll be fine. Besides, you may need me to have your back in case something goes wrong. Getting revenge on Princess Celestia and Twilight has always been in the back of my mind. Helping you out seems like the perfect revenge against them.
Shadow and Starlight must have found Will. They seem to have stopped traveling, and I can sense their powers off in that direction, about 1,200 miles away.
That would make sense. Will Atkinson's show is currently a mustard Equestria. It's unbelievable that you can sense powers. I guess that means you are pretty powerful. But then again, so is Shadow.
Now do you understand why I worry about you coming with me?
There is nothing to worry about. You said that in the future, Shadow and I are on friendly terms. And he's with Starlight. Trust me, I'll be fine. Starlight won't let him harm me either. We're practically sisters.
Now we get into the more pressing matter about how we decide to travel there. I think if either of us were to use our powers to teleport, Shadow would sense our arrival immediately. The same goes with flying.
We could always take a passenger train to Vancouver. It would take a few days, of course, to travel that distance, but he's there for the next 2 weeks, so we would be able to get there in time and undetected by Shadow.
I was afraid you were going to say that. I hate being around crowds, especially when they're all staring at you. But you're right. This would be the best way to travel. My main concern, though, is that they've beaten me to Will and have already warned him of my plans.
I wouldn't worry too much over it. Shadow and Starlight are complete strangers to Will of this time. What's to say Will won't listen to their warnings about you? And even so, if he does believe them and take their warning seriously, with your power, you should still be able to take down Shadow if he gets in your way. Right?
It's not a theory I want to test out, Sunset. I know what Shadow's power was like when he defeated Darkswirl. Even with the powers of two marks of Herc, I won't be able to match Shadow in power.
I'm not sure how much of the power his body retained when he transformed to defeat Darkswirl. My guess is he would have less power because part of that power came from the Chaos Emeralds. Regardless, a fight with Shadow is something we need to avoid, my dear. I think it's time we head out and catch a train out to Vancouver. Meanwhile, present-day Ponyville. Chris lands the X-Tornado behind Rarity's boutique.
Sorry, guys, but I had to drop the X-Tornado off here first, so it could be loaded up for my delivery route tomorrow. But, nevertheless, welcome to Ponyville.
So you work here, Chris?
Yep, I sure do. I'm in the fashion business now. Well, technically speaking, anyway, I deliver all of Rarity's clothing orders to her other two stores. Rarity is the owner and the head designer for her clothing line, Rarity for You. Chris and Chaotix exit the X-Tornado. Quite the transition from rocket engineer to clothing delivery guy. Yeah, but I love it. And to be honest, I make a pretty good living at it. So you guys are about to meet my boss and good friend Rarity. Just to give you guys a fair warning, she may be a little short considering this is the Grand Galloping Gala season and all. It's her busiest time of the year. Well, come on in, guys.
Chris opens the back door as they enter the loading area of the boutique.
Hey, Rarity, I'm back!
Rarity exits the war room to greet Chris.
Well, that certainly is the best news I've heard all day. You have quite a bit of deliveries to make, darling. Oh, and who are your friends? No doubt that they are Mobians.
Hi, it's a pleasure to meet you, Miss Rarity. The name is Vector. I'm Espio.
Charmy B.
Well, aren't you just adorable?
Charmy blushes. Aw, thanks. Yeah, I get that a lot.
Beam exits the war room.
Chaotix!
Oh, hey, Cream!
Charmy rushes to Cream and embraces her tightly.
It's nice to see you again, too. Charmy! Hi, Mr. Vector and Mr. Espio.
Hey, Cream, how have you been?
I'm living the dream, as they say.
I'll let you guys catch up while I start loading up the X-Tornado. After that, we'll head into town and I'll show you guys around. Chris walks away to begin loading the X-Tornado.
So, where have you guys been this whole time?
We just arrived here a few days ago.
Yeah, our ship was critically damaged as we were making our final approach to the planet.
Well, apparently we have Shadow to thank for that. But luckily we were able to land safely and bump into Chris in Manhattan. It was nice enough to give us a lift here to reunite with you guys.
Oh, wow. That was nice of Chris. Oh, hey, guess what, Charmy? After we left Mobius, I became a fashion designer.
That's amazing, Cream.
Yes, and I'm very fortunate to have our talents. Especially during this time of the year.
Ooh, Rarity. Speaking of which, do you think we'll have enough time to make my friends some formal attire for the gala, too?
Well, we certainly have the time, darling. But I'm not sure they're going to get invited. Twilight may have already received the tickets for the gala, but I guess it wouldn't hurt to try and ask Twilight about inviting them.
Oh, it's okay. You guys don't have to go through any extra trouble on our account.
Nonsense! I'm staying at Twilight's castle. I'll bring you guys over there so you can meet her, and I'm sure she'd be happy to get you guys tickets for the gala as well.
In that case, I didn't see any harm in getting you boys fitted properly for tuxes in the meantime. Since you're already here, please, right this way.
Oh, yay! We get some swanky new swag to wear. Awesome!
I can't wait to see you in a tux, Charmy. I bet you're gonna look adorable in one.
Well, thank you kindly, Miss Rarity.
Oh, there's no need to thank me, dear. We'll be having you boys. boy is looking fabulous in no time.
They follow Rarity into her war room. Meanwhile, 7 years in the past. And Hoover, Dino and Starlight arrive at the theater.
Well, it looks like the theater is closed. Looks like we'll have to hope to catch Will another time.
Will you stop that? Clearly you can hear them rehearsing in there. Why are you so afraid to see Will?
I'm not afraid to see of him. I just don't want to cause a scene or get in trouble for breaking into a theater that's clearly closed to the public.
Well then, why don't you just use your magic to teleport us inside?
You know, times you surprise me.
Always tend to panic when things don't go perfect or according to plan. You really should work on that and have more confidence in your abilities.
You know, that isn't the first time you said that to me. All right, I'll teleport us inside, but promise me that no matter what happens, you won't cause a scene or resort to violence.
Can't make that promise, but I will try my best to refrain.
I'm cautiously optimistic, but okay, here it goes.
Starlight uses her magic to teleport herself and Shadow into the auditorium of the theater. Shadow and Starlight are met with gazing glares as the room goes quiet as they appear inside the theater.
Excuse me, but you can't be in here. Rehearsal isn't open to the public.
Handle this, Shadow. Well, I'm very sorry for interrupting your rehearsal, but my friend and I came here to warn you that you're in danger.
Every pony starts laughing at Starlight.
She's not joking. If we could have a few moments of your time, I promise we'll explain everything. If you don't trust us, then by all means you can have some pony accompany you.
Twilight, being on vacation from serving Princess Celestia, is in attendance.
I'll step in and have your back, Mr. Atkinson. I am Princess Celestia's apprentice and all.
Twilight! What are you doing here?
Shadow, you idiot! She doesn't know you, remember?
I happened to be on vacation. I was enjoying the rehearsal. Not that it's any of your business, but I am a big fan of Will Atkinson's work.
I see. Well, I promise we won't take up too much of your time. My sincere apologies, Twilight.
How exactly do you know me? You're blushing, and your tone says you know me very well, and yet I have no clue who you are. You two have some serious explaining to do.
Well, our cover is blown. We may as well tell them everything now at this point. So much for avoiding Twilight on this mission.
It's too late to worry about that now. Geez, Starlight, you act like I did this on purpose. But nevertheless, Twilight, there's a lot we do need to explain, and Equestria's safety is at risk. We really would appreciate it if both you and Will Atkinson give us just a few moments of your time in private, please.
I'm all right with this, if you are, Will. We can go to your dressing room for privacy. I'm a little perplexed by all of this, but okay, let's hear what you two have to say. The four of them make their way to Will's office/dressing room. They enter the room and close the door behind them.
All right, start talking. I'll explain it, Starlight. You can chime in whenever you like.
That's fine by me. However, I would recommend leaving the personal history between the four of us out of this conversation, considering these two don't even care about all of that.
I will try my best, Starlight. I'm sure this seems strange, but we were sent here by Princess Celestia. You see, we came here from 7 years in the future.
Time travel? But that's impossible! No pony in Equestria can perform Star Swirl's time travel spell. Not even Princess Celestia. And furthermore, it's forbidden. There's no way Princess Celestia would ever allow you two to travel through time.
Starlight knows how to perform said time travel spell. But I can assure you, my dear, that Princess Celestia of our dimension indeed sent us here. It was her idea, in fact. In our time dimension, we are currently pursuing a threat to Equestria's safety. His name is Aeon the Hedgehog. Aeon used his magic crystal to open a portal to this timeline in an attempt to absorb Will's Mark of Hurt powers to become the God of Power. But that's just a myth. Freak not, Your Highness.
Shadow!
Your Highness? You mean I'm actually royalty in the future? Princess Celestia looked past my lineage to Nightshade? Starlight face hooves.
Yes, she did. You are the ruler of your pony in our timeline.
It's true, but that's not what's important. Aeon has already absorbed 2/3 of the Triad of Power in our timeline. The only Mark of Herc he hasn't absorbed yet is you, Will. If he succeeds, he will become the God of Power.
Wait, if Will exists in your timeline, then why did this Aeon guy go through the trouble of traveling through time?
We believe Aeon chose this time for a couple of reasons. The first being that in this timeline, there is no pony protecting Will. The other reason is Sunset Shimmer.
Sunset is out of Tartarus? I must warn Princess Celestia immediately.
No, Twilight. Sunset served her time in Tartarus and was set free. The war Princess Celestia must never know of our conversation.
I have to warn her of what's going on and the serious threat that Equestria faces.
Starlight and I will handle the situation from here. There's no need to worry, Twilight. Neither Aeon or Sunset are a match for me, which is exactly why Aeon chose to come here to absorb Will's powers.
I'm also very close with Sunset, Twilight. I'm pretty sure I can convince her to join our side, or perhaps even get her to convince Aeon to back down his own plan.
Sunset is my mortal enemy.
Yes, but she's changed her ways, at least in our timeline, and she has you to thank for that.
Hey, but she absolutely hates my guts and has attempted to kill me. How could I possibly?
I know it's hard to understand, but trust me. The Sunset of our time died about a week ago, sacrificing herself to save your life, Twilight.
Wow. So, I take it we're all pretty close, huh? How do you know me? Please.
Shadow, we've already told her too much. If we tell her much more, it will alter the natural flow of our timeline.
She's right. That's why time travel is forbidden.
The damage was already done when Aeon arrived here. Have dinner with me tonight, Twilight, and I promise I'll explain everything you need to know.
Shadow!
I guess dinner would be alright.
Fantastic! We can meet up back here later on tonight, and you can pick the restaurant. But Spike cannot know about this, and under no circumstances is he to send a letter to Princess Celestia about what's going on. Again, Aeon is our problem, and I assure you, we will take care of him, peacefully.
Twilight, in absolute shock, Shadow knows about Spike. I'm a little bit shook by all of this. Alright, I won't tell Spike or Princess Celestia about any of this. I don't understand why, but I trust you for some strange reason. When I look at you, you look at me as though I matter a great deal to you.
This is a very bad idea, Shadow. You're putting the natural flow of history for this timeline in jeopardy. This dinner of yours could change everything for this dimension.
I can't help it, Starlight. I can't pretend that this dimension's Twilight doesn't matter to me. She's still my princess.
Twilight, completely shocked, and is blushing and breathing heavy. Shadow grabs Twilight by her hoof and kisses it.
I promise you, Twilight, we will make sure nothing happens to your timeline.
I don't know what to say right now. You're acting like you're in love with me, which is crazy because I don't even know you.
I know how odd this seems, but I promise, I'm going to tell you everything tonight.
Great. Now what about Will and keeping him safe?
You can only assume that Aeon sensed our powers the moment we came through that time portal, so he knows we're here. I suggest that Will stay here and conducts his business as if nothing is going on. We'll stay here and protect him and wait for Aeon to make his move.
Meanwhile, present time Ponyville.
This is Ponyville? If what you said was true about that fight with Darkswirl, I'm in shock that this town looks so beautiful.
Yeah, Chris, for a town that was supposedly decimated, it doesn't even look like there was a battle here at all.
That's because of Discord. He used magic to reverse all the damage that was done. But yeah, this is where we call home.
You know, it's not the big city we landed in, but this town is a bustling little place.
Yeah, there's a lot to do in this town. Good restaurants, great shopping, great friends, and there's a lot of cool festivals and whatnot here too. I'm not sure about you guys, but I can go for some lunch, and I know the perfect place to go.
Yeah, I can go for some grub. How about it, guys?
Well, you are our tour guide and all, Chris, so yeah.
I want something sweet. That cupcake-looking building has definitely caught my attention.
Lunch, Charmy. Lunch.
They do have lunch, and it's funny you mentioned that building, Charmy, because it's exactly where we're going. It's called Sugar Cube Corner. Amy works there, as does my friend Pinkie Pie.
Hey, Sonic!
Ugh, oh man, Chaotix! It's great to see you guys again.
Sonic rushes over to greet them.
It's great to see you again as well, but I have a serious axe to grind with you, and Knuckles too for that matter.
Yeah, we're pretty upset with you guys not giving us a Chaos Emerald during the fight with the Metarex. You guys left us behind.
Yeah, about that. We kind of had to use the Chaos Emeralds in a hurry. I didn't think we were going to have to use them in the manner in which we did. But hey, at least you guys made it here safely.
I wouldn't call it safely, Sonic. We crash-landed here thanks to Shadow.
Shadow? Well, what did he have to do with it?
That clown shot an energy blast that left the surface of the planet as we were making our final approach, and it took out our engines, forcing us to crash here.
funny, I don't remember that. But then again, I was the bad guy this time around. Evil spell. My mind was corrupted, and that's all I'll say on the matter. Yeah, we really had a couple of intense battles here, and the funny thing is that Eggman hasn't been responsible for any of it.
So, Eggman made it here as well?
No, not yet, but from what we've heard, he's definitely on his way here. I'll assume you guys used your Chaos Emerald Finder on your ship's computer to find us, huh?
You assume correctly.
Look, for the record, I'm sorry we didn't plan ahead by giving you guys a Chaos Emerald during the fight with the Metarex. Everything happened so fast, and who would have thought Mobius would be destroyed?
It's alright, Sonic, we were just giving you some grief. Luckily for us, we did manage to arrive here in one piece, and that Chris and your brother Manic happened to dine at the same restaurant we were dining in.
Yeah, talk about a shock. Needless to say, once I heard about their story, I offered to bring them here to reunite with everyone. Actually, we were getting ready to head over to Sugar Cube Corner for some lunch, if you're interested, Sonic.
Nah, I'll pass this time. I'm heading out west to watch Rainbow Dash play tonight.
That's your wife, right?
Yep, she sure is. She's a professional Pegasus ball player, and I'm running out to Tall Tale to watch her play tonight. Anyway, guys, I gotta run, but it's definitely awesome to see you guys again. We'll have to get together and catch up soon.
No doubt!
See ya, Sonic! Enjoy watching your wife play!
I always do, even though at times it gets a bit nerve-wracking seeing her take hits like she does. But my Dashie is one tough girl. Anyway, guys, see ya!
Bye, Sonic!
Sonic bolts off towards Tall Tale.
It's a wonder he never gets a cramp or something! Sheesh!
Well, guys, here we are, Sugar Cube Corner.
They enter.
Chris, you're back! Chaotix! Oh my god, it's so great to see you guys again! Where have you been?
Amy comes out from behind the counter and hugs Chris and Chaotix.
Well, up until a few days ago, just traveling through space. You know how it goes. You look just as beautiful as ever, Amy.
Yeah, thanks. Despite me being covered in raw batter and flour. I'm working alone today, Chris. The cakes are still away and Pinkie Pie hasn't come out of her apartment again today.
Have you tried talking to her?
Yeah, like a dozen times. She either tells me to go away or doesn't say anything at all. Please tell me you've talked some sense into Manic about wanting to leave Pinkie Pie and Ponyville.
I did, but Manic stayed behind in Manhattan to look at some more apartments. He seems pretty serious about this move, Amy.
You know, I'm so disappointed in him bailing on Pinkie Pie the way he has. He's been through so much worse than this with his life choices on Mobius.
We can't judge him, though, Amy. Evil spell aside, it was Pinkie who stabbed Manic. You can't expect him to just erase the visual of that from his brain. I'm hoping Manic's move is temporary once he heals from the emotional damage that was done to him. But I do believe that this move of his is necessary. He can't be around her right now.
Well, we can talk about this later. I am sure you boys are hungry, huh?
Famished, to be honest.
Yeah, I want something sweet, and those donuts look incredible.
No way, kid. You can have a donut after you've eaten something hearty, like a sandwich.
For once, Vector, you see things my way.
Well, you're in luck. I have fresh baked croissant sandwiches coming out of the oven in a few minutes. Speaking of which, I'd love to stay and catch up with you guys, but I'm way behind at the moment, so I gotta run. I'll be sure to bring you all a sandwich once they're done.
Sounds great, Amy.
Amy rushes away and heads back to the kitchen. To Amy's shock, Pinkie Pie is rummaging through the bakery refrigerator.
Holy crap, you're alive! Think you could pull it together for a few hours and help me?
Pinkie Pie is very somber throughout.
No, you'll be fine. I just came to grab some ice cream out of the bakery freezer. I ran out.
Amy grabs the carton of ice cream in from Pinkie Pie's hooves and throws it at the wall as the carton explodes.
Hey, you had no right to! No, I had every right to do what I did. I'm seriously struggling out here, and you had the nerve to come into this kitchen and take company ice cream just because you're depressed and you ran out. You have no idea what I'm going through right now. I've never been so sad. I understand and I want to be here as a friend, but you won't let me in or come out here to talk. I went through the same thing when Sonic broke my heart to be with Rainbow Dash. Yeah, it hurt, but I moved on with my life.
But I love Manic so much. I messed up so bad, and now he's leaving for evil forever. I just want to hold him and tell him how sorry I am.
Amy embraces Pinkie Pie.
Look, right now Manic can't face you because all he sees is you stabbing him with that knife. He's been through worse in his life and has pulled through it with no problems. I really think he just needs some time away to get his head straight and to heal from what happened. Manic knows you're the greatest thing that's ever happened to him and he loves you deeply. I have no doubt he'll be back and think that this move is temporary.
But what if it's not? I never pictured the rest of my life without him.
I think part of the problem is that you've hidden yourself away in pity and haven't focused on anything but what you did. You love this place and baking, and I'm here, so why not come to work and do something you're passionate about? It seriously helped me focus on something other than Sonic. And besides, Manic will be here for the album release party on Saturday night. You'll have a chance to talk to him then.
Pinkie Pie perks up a bit.
Yeah, maybe you're right. This place does make me happy, and I do have you here to talk to. I just hope Manikins gives me a chance to apologize and doesn't plan on giving up on us. I'm sorry I've left you in such a bind these past few days. It's okay. I've been there with Sonic, and I understand. If you need a place to stay because you can't handle being here alone, I'd be more than happy to let you stay with us for a while until you heal yourself.
Thanks, Amy. You're a great friend, but I think it would be best if I got used to being on my own again.
Manic may not be coming home, so I need to get used to it. Why is it that nobody ever takes me up on my offer? Because you and Chris have an amazing thing going and nobody wants to poop on that party. Anyways, let me freshen up and I'll be down in like 20 minutes. Okie dokie lokie.
Yeah, and when you come down, I'll be taking a nice hour lunch. Screw that! After running this place by yourself for the last week, go home and take the rest of the day off. And tomorrow too. I got this covered. Thanks for being such a great friend, Amy.
What else would you expect? You aren't my pinky sister and all.
Meanwhile, 7 years into the past.
Aeon and Sunset Shimmer riding the train to Vancouver.
How long of a train ride are we looking at here, Sunset?
We should arrive tomorrow afternoon. So what exactly is our plan here?
Will's show opens tomorrow night. I say we give the fans a show they'll never forget.
Right. You know, all 6 of his shows in Vancouver are sold out. We won't be stepping hoof, or in your case, foot, into that theater.
Seeing the show was never my plan. We'll use brute force to enter the theater. With Shadow being there, it would be best to attack head-on and cause as much chaos as possible. Once I absorb Will's power, Shadow will be no match for me.
For once, I don't agree with this plan. Mainly because the last time I tried the whole let's just attack and catch them off guard approach, I wound up in Tartarus for the last 5 years.
I can assure you, my dear Sunset, Tartarus is a place we won't wind up in. If this plan goes badly, we'll just use my crystal to open a portal to a different dimension and escape that way.
Now, who's using dimensional portals to escape their problems?
I'm not using these portals to escape my problems, Sunset. I'm using them to ensure my future as the god of power and the supreme ruler of this universe.
Fair enough. So what time dimension will we go to?
With Shadow being here, I may consider going back to my timeline. There would be a risk, of course, of the Elements of Harmony and the Chaos Emeralds being used against me. But I like those odds.
Then why not just go back there outright if your odds are better?
Here we are only fighting Shadow. There we are up against a legion of adversaries. And if the Elements of Harmony and Chaos Emeralds are used, they create a weapon that not even the powers of a god can withstand.
You really do things haphazardly, don't you?
It's been my way of life for many, many years, my dear. My village and everyone I ever knew was wiped out for the powers of this crystal I possess. I lived most of my life on the run, hopping and skipping through time so he could never find me.
Who?
Eclipse the Darkling. And it's not just him either. He has quite the extermination squad as well, and they've spent years trying to hunt me down for this crystal. That is why I seek the powers of the Triad of Power. Gaining it would allow me to become the Hunter, to finally exact my revenge on those bastards for what they've done.
Oh, I'm sorry you had to go through that. I see now why your soul is so hardened. Mine is because of my mother. I was always forced to do her bidding for her. I had a fiancé once until she killed him, because I refused to carry out her wishes for revenge on Princess Celestia. I was next if I didn't agree to help her, so I did. Now do you understand why I flee to the mirror world as much as I do?
Regardless, with me at your side, you'll never have to worry about your mother again. And in my dimension, she's already dead.
That's comforting to know. I never thought there could be any pony strong enough to take her down. Aeon, do you mind telling me the story of how we fell in love?
I could if you really want me to, but I am no fool. While you may be similar to my dimension, Sunset, I know there are subtle differences between the two of you. I'd rather us fall in love naturally, all over again. I want us to fall in love naturally like we did the first time. I don't want you to feel obligated to love me because of the history I shared with your future self.
Only time will tell, I guess. But I am attracted and intrigued by you. I'd say we're off to a pretty good start.
Aeon began telling past Sunset Shimmer about the history he had shared with her future self and how they fell in love. Much like her future counterpart, she was naturally attracted to Aeon. He also shared a dark past as well, so she easily related to what he was going through and his lust for power. She wasn't in love yet, but knew she wanted to remain at Aeon's side. Aeon also told Sunset about how she befriended Twilight and became her apprentice. Sunset was shocked to hear the full story, but was somewhat happy to know her and Twilight managed to find peace with one another. Many hours have passed. It's now after 7 p.m. in both dimensions. Shadow and past Twilight have since met at the restaurant that Twilight had picked out for their dinner. Twilight is sitting at her table for two alone, trembling in a nervous excitement awaiting Shadow's arrival. She's deeply intrigued to see him again and is eager to learn more about him. Twilight has already gathered that Shadow is someone significant to her future self and that she matters a great deal to him. Twilight gasps lightly as she sees Shadow enter the restaurant. She very quickly uses her magic to hold the menu up close to her face so Shadow couldn't see her blushing. Shadow arrives at the table.
I'm sorry I'm a bit late. I had an issue to iron out with Starlight back at our hotel.
It's all right. I'm not upset or anything like that.
You're nervous.
Shadow takes the menu away from Twilight's face.
Really? How can you tell?
You do that little giggle when you're uncomfortable or uneasy. You also do it when you're nervous or embarrassed, too.
Sato sits in his chair and places his hand on her left front hoof. Shadow looks Twilight in her eyes.
It's all right, Twilight. You have nothing to be nervous about.
I'm trembling. You have no idea how much so. My heart is pounding through my chest, and I have no idea why, considering we just met this morning. But being from the future like you are, clearly my future self matters a great deal to you.
I know sharing Deering with you tonight isn't probably the best idea. When Starlight and I came through the portal, we made it a priority for us not to meet you or any of our friends. Meeting any of you would put the natural balance of this timeline in jeopardy, but you especially as it pertains to me. I shouldn't be telling you any of this.
Then don't. I don't want to know. This is why time travel is forbidden, because it puts history at risk. But there's something major going on between you and me. I can feel the tension already. The way you look at me? No pony has ever looked at me like that.
In my timeline, you are my fiancé. And we're also having a baby together. I'm sorry for the way I acted earlier. Kissing your hoof at the theater the way I did? I saw you and I just couldn't help myself. Even though there are physical differences, you and the Twilight of my time are exactly alike.
We're engaged? Oh my, and I'm a child?
Yes. We're having a girl, if you must know.
Oh, wow. That explains why you're so passionate with me.
Yes, and I feel a little guilty about that. Despite a few differences, you're exactly like my princess.
That's the second time you've called me that. Your princess? And you've mentioned differences as well.
I've never seen you without your wings before. That's the only difference between you and my Twilight. I probably shouldn't have said that. But you inquired, and I don't keep secrets from you.
So, I'm a Pegasus in your dimension?
No, you are so much more. Let it sink in a moment.
You're a princess? I'm an Alicorn?
Yes, you are. The Princess of Friendship, to be exact. It's okay, Twilight. Breathe. Everything works out fine, believe me. Damn it! Starlight was right. This dinner was a very bad idea.
Waiter walks up to the table. Are you two ready to order?
Can we get a few more minutes, please?
Certainly. Waiter walks away.
I'm sorry, Shadow. I shouldn't have pushed it out of you, but I needed to know. The way you've acted towards me when I've only just met you today, finding out you're from the future, clearly, I mean a great deal to you in your timeline. I had to know the truth.
The you in my dimension means everything to me. There is nothing I wouldn't do for you, but I put this timeline's natural history in jeopardy by telling you all of this. Starlight knew this would happen. She knew I wouldn't be able to control myself around you. The truth is, my heart began pounding through my chest when I saw you this morning. I know I shouldn't feel this way about you because of the relationship I share with you in the future. It's almost like I'm cheating on my princess.
Would you relax? You haven't done anything wrong here. I mean, it's just dinner, right? I'm sure the Twilight of your time would be happy knowing you took the time to have dinner with me. It would show her that you care. And my heart melts every time you call me your princess. How does it happen, Shadow, between us?
I can't share the details with you, but the only advice I'll give you is to do every task Princess Celestia gives you while you serve as her apprentice. Everything you've done so far, and everything you'll ever do from this point forward, is preparing you for it. Just believe in yourself. Don't ever doubt your abilities, because you're incredible. I've never met anyone like you. I've changed so much since you've become part of my life. I really should be saying this to my Twilight, but...
What, you haven't?
No, I've definitely told her this before. Alright, let's just order dinner and change the subject. I'm saying things to you I shouldn't, and it's not right to play with your emotions like that. And you already know more than you should. I just hope none of this has a negative effect on your future here.
Our future already changed the moment your energy-stealing friend opened his portal to our world. You and Starlight are not to blame for anything that happens.
Even still, I shouldn't have opened up to you as much as I have. I understand now why Starlight wanted me to avoid meeting you in this time. She knew I wouldn't be able to deny my feelings for my Twilight upon seeing you. It was wrong of me treating you the way I have today. I'm playing with your emotions, and it's not right.
It's okay, Shadow. I'm honestly enjoying the attention. I've never had a guy treat me the way you have, and it feels really good. But therein lies the problem.
Exactly. We both know that my time in your world is temporary. And I'm sorry if my actions today are making you feel things for me that you shouldn't.
We must be one heck of a couple where you come from. I look at you, and it's clear to me that nothing means more to you than the love you share with me in your time. And judging by what I'm feeling right now, I think the same holds true for me. Tell me, please, Shadow, how and when will I meet you?
I can't share that with you. Hell, I'm not even sure if things will play out the same in your timeline as it did in mine. You may not even meet me in this reality, but if you do, just remember the me you meet the first day we meet isn't the guy I am, especially as it pertains to you.
Well, I find you to be an amazing hedgehog, Shadow. I wish you could tell me more, but I understand why you can't. And don't worry, I won't tell Princess Celestia that we met, or what we've discussed today. I promise, your secret is safe with me.
Shadow gives Twilight a smile.
I know it is, Twilight.
Meanwhile, back in the present-day timeline of Equestria, Fluttershy's cottage. Rarity and Capper arrive.
Oh, hi. Sorry I haven't been at work this week.
Well, honestly, dear, that's why Capper and I stopped by this evening. We were worried about you and wanted to check in on you. And to perhaps inquire as to when you may be coming back. I mean, it is the gala season and all, darling.
I'm sorry, Rarity, but I'm not coming back to work. Consider this my official resignation.
You're quitting?
Now, Rarity, please attempt to remain calm.
I am calm! Now, Fluttershy, darling, I can understand taking a few days off to heal from what happened, but you're walking away from an amazing career and a lot of money.
Oh, for goodness sake, Rarity. I just had my heart broken. And so easy for you, isn't it? We get turned evil and attack our loved ones, and you simply just move on like nothing happened.
I have reflected on what happened, but life must go on. And I have my business to attend to and customers to make happy.
And I have my animals to tend to. Tails moved out, and as a result, I have no pony watching over them at the sanctuary. My responsibility now is to go back to my roots and taking care of my animals. I can't just turn my back on them to work for you.
Well, have you considered perhaps asking Tails to continue taking care of the animal sanctuary? I mean, we would hate to lose you, dear, especially when you're incredibly talented.
Rarity's right. You do some fine work, Fluttershy.
Tails offered to do that so I could work for you. He was only trying to be a supportive boyfriend. I can't expect him to do that now that we've broken up.
Well, then offer him a job! I'm sure the vet clinic was paying you some money to rehabilitate the animals. Just pay Tails that money!
No, I've made my decision, Rarity, and I'm sorry, but I'm not coming back to Rarity for you. My first love in life was taking care of the animals, and that's what I'm going to do.
Fine, you are correct. It is your decision, and clearly you've made it. Good luck, Fluttershy. I hope those fluffy bird balls pays your bills. Let's go, Capper.
I guess so much for you actually checking up on me.
Come here, Fluttershy. Capper quickly embraces Fluttershy as she cries into his arms.
Oh, Fluttershy, I'm terribly sorry for what I just said.
It's all right, Rarity.
Let it out, Shy.
I love him. I love Tails so much. And my heart has been ripped to pieces. I nearly killed my
Cosmos who showed up and ruined your relationship with Tails. Had she stayed dead, you and Tails probably would have been able to fix this.
Clarity!
Well, it's true, isn't it, Shy?
Yeah. Tails did say that Cosmo being back changes everything. He said that if Cosmo hadn't died to begin with, he would have never fallen in love with me.
You see, it wasn't Dark Swirl's magic at all.
Regardless, I never truly meant anything to him, and I need to move on.
Meanwhile, Twilight's castle. Twilight's sitting in her comfy chair reading. Hey, is everything okay, Twilight?
Yeah, I think I'm handling everything okay. I'm trying not to think about Shadow at the moment. What about you? You seem to be enjoying Cream's company again. Do you want to talk about it?
It's been rough, honestly, Twilight. I'm thankful she's back and get to see her again, but it's been rough knowing that the feelings are still there between us, and we can't do anything about it. I get it. And there's also your relationship with Sweetie Belle, which has been kind of put on hold this past week because of Cream's return. Yeah, I don't mean for it to be like that, but I'm trying to spend as much time with Cream as I can before she has to leave again.
Spike, you need to spend more time with Sweetie Belle, if I'm being honest. She can't take the back seat every time Cream comes home. It's pretty obvious Cream doesn't want a relationship, and quite frankly, she won't have time for it once she really starts fulfilling her duties as an angel. And one of her tasks, before she becomes one officially, is getting you to move on with your life without her. I really thought I was past all of this. If anything, Cream being back proves that maybe I never truly was. I get with what you're saying, though, about Cream having a major responsibility and her being gone again, and then I do need to focus my time on Sweetie Belle, because I do love her.
Exactly, Spike. You're not Tails. I would be highly disappointed in you if you broke Sweetie Belle's heart in the same manner as Tails did with Fluttershy, which is exactly why I'm going to be charging Tails and Cosmo Rep for staying here. I don't mind them staying, but they did Fluttershy wrong, and they won't be freeloading off me.
I would never do Sweetie Belle like that. I legitimately love that girl. She was here for me when I was grieving Cream's death. There's just so much unresolved feelings with Cream, and I love her just as much as I do Sweetie Belle. I wasn't expecting her to return like she has. You know, I have talked to Cream, and she's just as much in love with you as you are her, but she also knows that she has to let you go too. This is just as much a test for her as it is for you, Spike. She can't continue on with being an angel if she doesn't let you go.
What exactly are you saying, Twilight?
If you love Cream as much as you claim to, Spike, then you need to let her go. If you're incapable of this, then Cosmo's race may take back her angelic powers, in which case she'll return to the dead. Is that what you want for her?
No, of course not. But how though, Twilight? How do I let Cream go again?
You did it once before, Spike. This time should be much easier.
The front doors to the castle open as Cream has returned.
Spike and Twilight exit the den and go out to greet Cream.
Hey, Spike. Hey, Twilight. I brought some old friends of mine for you guys to meet. They just arrived here from Mobius a few days ago and crash-landed here in their spaceship.
Oh, well, welcome to Equestria and my castle. My name is Princess Twilight Sparkle, and I'm the Princess of Friendship.
Chaotix bows to Princess Twilight Sparkle.
It's an honor to meet you, Your Highness. I didn't realize we were going to meet royalty today. We would have dressed for the occasion.
There's no need for all that. You'll come to find that I'm not your average princess.
Yeah, she's the rough and tumble type. I'm Spike the Dragon, Twilight's adopted brother and royal advisor.
Nice to meet you guys. I'm Vector, the leader of the Chaotix investigation team.
And I'm Charmy, Charmy B.
And I'm Espio, Your Highness.
Well, again, welcome to Friendship Castle. Please, have a seat in my den, and we can get acquainted further.
Spike and Cream lead Chaotix into the den.
Hey, Twilight, is Tails around?
Yeah, the last time I saw him, he was doing some mechanical work in my lab.
Oh, all right. Thanks, Twilight. You're welcome, Chris. Are these Chaotix guys? Oh, yeah, they're completely cool. I met them when they came to my world, so no worries.
Ew, that's a relief. Wow, there are so many new faces and new friends from Mobius coming here recently. It's really exciting. Anyway, I better tend to our new guests. See you around, Chris. Definitely, and you're right. It is exciting seeing all these new faces lately. Only makes our team stronger, right? Yeah, it does. Twilight gives Chris a smile and heads off into her den. Chris walks up the flight of stairs leading to Twilight's laboratory. Enters. Hales immediately stops working on his project to acknowledge Chris.
Oh, hey, Chris. What's going on?
A lot, actually. And do you have a few minutes to talk?
Of course I have a few minutes. I was just tinkering around with some stuff anyway. So what's up, Chris?
I have a project. Well, perhaps a potential project for you to work on in Manhattan.
Okay, I guess I'll have a look at it. What exactly are we talking about here, Chris?
It's Chaotix. They're here at Twilight's castle. They crash-landed in Manhattan during our fight with Darkswirl, and I wanted to get a second opinion on their ship.
Chaotix is here? How awesome! Yeah, I'll definitely go out to Manhattan and see what I can do.
All right, then. Meet me at Rarity's Boutique tomorrow morning at 7, and I'll drop you off at their ship when I make my stop in Manhattan in the afternoon.
Sounds like a plan. I gotta go downstairs and say hi to the boys.
Tails and Chris head back down towards Twilight's Den. Meanwhile, Twilight's Den.
Wow, that's quite the story. And I'm sorry that Shadow's energy blast shot you guys down. If there's anything you guys need money-wise to cover the damages, I can try to cover it. Or have Princess Celestia cover it.
No way! It's not your fault Shadow has bad aim!
Yeah, but she still feels guilty that Shadow is responsible.
Shadow is my fiancé, and if he damaged your ship, I feel partly responsible for those damages. I mean, it was part of my borrowed powers that kind of led to that blast, so yeah. I can't believe a girl like you would ever be engaged to a guy like him.
Mr. Shadow has changed a lot, you guys. He is not the brute he once was and has become a vital part to this planet's safety.
Tails and Chris enter the room.
Hey, Chaotix!
Aha! Tails, my dude!
What? Can't fix your ship on your own and now you gotta have me look at it? How typical of you, Charmy.
Dude, it's fried. You can look at it if you want, but I guarantee you'll come up with the same diagnostic report as I have.
Yeah, I'm an expert at this stuff too, and I'd have to say I concur with Charmy on this one. But hey, it doesn't hurt to have a third expert look at it. I mean, if history has proven anything, it's that Tails can fix everything. Yeah, everything that's mechanical. Emotional stuff, that's a different story.
Wait, what's that supposed to mean, Twilight?
Means you may be a genius when it comes down to scientific things, but when it comes down to dealing with ponies' emotions like Fluttershy, you're a complete and utter idiot! Oh, on that note, I'm gonna head out of here. I haven't spent much time with Amy these past few days. Tails, I'll see you tomorrow. Good luck! Chris leaves quickly.
Wait, Chris, take me with you!
Oh no, Miles, Tails Prower. I have a huge issue with you at the moment.
Look, with all due respect, Twilight, I don't owe you any explanation as how to handle my breakup with Fluttershy. And to be frank, it's none of your business!
Yes, again, Tails. It is my business, because when you walked out on Fluttershy, I took you and your homewrecker Cosmo in. He comes back and you throw your relationship with Fluttershy away?
It's not that simple, Twilight. Cosmo is my fiancé, technically. And if it weren't for her sacrifice on Mobius, we wouldn't even be alive right now. Never mind the fact that Fluttershy and I never would have gotten together had Cosmo survived and came with us. So please show her a little more respect.
Yeah, but you hurt Fluttershy. You broke her heart.
She attacked me and nearly killed me, Twilight.
She was under an evil spell, though.
Yeah, I get that. But you have no idea how hard it was being verbally and physically assaulted by her. I stood by and chose not to defend myself as she was beating me to a pulp. All because I do love her. Combine that with my history with Cosmo, and you'll understand why I chose to leave her. It's really the same reason why Manic can't be around Pinkie Pie. It's not that he doesn't love her or care about her. It's because all he sees is the attack and the vicious nature Pinkie attacked him with. Fluttershy did the same thing to me. There was no reasoning with her, and no hesitation with her actions either. You don't think it hurts, Twilight?
I'm sorry. I also know what being under an evil spell is like. I know exactly how it feels to lose control of yourself. I just wish the outcome could have been different.
Me too. I never thought I'd ever leave Fluttershy or have Cosmo back. But you can't be upset with me for how things have played out.
Twilight drops her magic as the doors to her den open. Again, I'm sorry, Tails. I had no right judging you or Cosmo like that.
It's okay. The past several days have been emotional for all of us, and Fluttershy is one of your most dear friends. So I understand sticking up for her.
I have my own question I'd like to ask. There was a legend about a pony race living on Mobius, but they were said to have been wiped out by humans over 30,000 years ago. Are you ponies that missing race?
Yes. The story that's been told on your planet about us being wiped out was false. Our race was banished to this world by the Echidnas to protect the Chaos Emeralds from falling into the hooves of our ruler of that time, Princess Saletta. Why do you ask, Espio?
No reason in particular. It just explains why the Master Emerald chose this world during Chaos Control. I always knew there was more to the story than what was told to us. It just didn't seem fitting that a race as powerful as the Equestrian Empire would fall to the humans.
Believe me, I was shocked by the truth when we figured it out. We never knew we came from Mobius. Let's just say circumstances led to the truth coming out. Hey, Cream?
Yeah, Spike?
Do you think we could talk in private?
Absolutely. Lead the way.
Cream follows Spike out to one of the outdoor terraces.
Nice night, huh?
Yeah, it is beautiful, Spike. This is feeling a lot like deja vu, isn't it?
Yeah, that's kind of why I brought you out to this terrace. It was almost a year ago during Rouge's farewell party where you and I came out to this very terrace. We professed our love for one another.
I know. I haven't forgotten. I couldn't possibly. It was the best day of my life. Spike, why did you bring me out here?
Look, this isn't easy to say. I love you. I always will. And when you love someone as much as I love you, every decision you make should be out of love. It's difficult as it is for me to stand here, the place where we profess our love for each other, to tell you now that this is where our love must end, is easily the most difficult thing I've ever had to do. I will always love you. I always will be here for you, Cream. But my heart, it belongs to Sweetie Belle. And I have to let you go.
Cream begins crying as she embraces Spike.
I'm sorry, Cream.
You have nothing to be sorry for, Spike. The truth is, I love you more than anything in existence, and I'm glad you've decided to let me go, because I was beginning to want to be with you again. And if I had chosen that path, I wouldn't be allowed to stay in the living world. I'm genuinely happy you opened your heart after my death and fell in love again with Sweetie Belle. She's truly a lucky girl to have you. Thank you for letting me go, because I wouldn't have been able to do what you just did. I love you, Spike. And as you know me being an angel, I'll always be here for you too.
Come here, Cream. I'm sorry things didn't turn out better for us. I wish I would have been there to protect you when the changelings attacked.
My death was never your fault, Spike. So stop blaming yourself for it. Do you think Sweetie Belle would be up for some ice cream?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure she would be.
Then let's go!
Manic walks into a rave party club. Oh yeah, the old Manic is back.
Time to see how much trouble I can get into. Oh, she looks easy. Hey, kid. You know it's not cool to dance all alone. Care to be my dance partner for the night?
But I'm not dancing alone. I came with my friends.
Yeah, that's whatever. Name's Manic.
I'm Pacific Ground.
Nice to meet you, but you never answer my question, kid. You want to be my dance partner for the night?
Look, I may be into partying and stuff, but I'm not that easy, kid. Find me a drink and we'll see if you're cool enough to be my dance partner for the night.
Alright, kid, you're on, but I guarantee it won't take half a drink to convince you.
Boy, you're awfully confident, aren't you? I can tell you've done this before.
Yeah, I am a rock star. This is all part of the territory, you know.
Believe it or not, I know exactly who you are. You're that drummer from the DJ Pawn 3 band. And you're not that bad of a singer or dancer.
I'm impressed. I'm famous already, and our first album doesn't drop for another day yet.
Well, my friends and I were Ponyville last year for the Rah-Rah concert that you guys debuted in. No, it was a shame we were all over that party pony from that. Thank you, Todd. Otherwise, I probably would have partied with you that night.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah, you're such a total hottie. I couldn't stop staring at you the whole time you were performing. So what ever happened to Pinkie Pie?
We've recently broke up. Yeah, she literally was gonna cut my heart out.
What? You cheat on her or something?
No, she fell under an evil spell and legitimately attempted to kill me. I can't look at her the same, evil spell or not. All I see is her stabbing me. If it weren't for my friends showing up when they did, she would have killed me for sure. What about you?
Bah, I don't need love. One time I was out of tech and I was done with the concert. Now I'm just about having fun without the emotional baggage.
You know, we haven't even ordered drinks yet. I feel like we both want to be each other's dance partners for the night.
Pacific Low places her hoof on Manic's chest and begins rubbing it.
I guess you were right about not making it through half a drink. Care to dance, Manic?
You're on, kid. But I should warn you, though. It's gonna get a little crazy tonight.
We'll see if you make it that far. Now how about that dance for tonight?
They go out to the dance floor and start dancing.
Meanwhile, 7 years in the past.
A tipsy Shadow walks Twilight back to her hotel room.
It's been a while since we've gone out and had fun like this, Twilight. Light. Dinner was wonderful. Thank you.
No, I should be the one thanking you. You made me feel special today, Shadow. The truth is, I don't get out very much. And I don't have many friends, let alone any handsome guys, to share a dinner with. I can see why the me of your time loves you so much.
My love with Twilight, I know this is going to sound cliche, but it's the greatest thing that's ever happened to me. There truly is nothing I wouldn't do for her. Our love alone has saved Equestria twice. If you ask me, that's true love if I've ever seen it.
You'll have to tell me the stories of what happened. It sounds really romantic.
Hardly. It was more the feelings we shared that saved us. The details of which I can't share. You know that.
I know, Shadow. Well, we're almost to my room. Do you maybe want to stay the night?
Tempting. Very tempting. But I can't. As much as you are Twilight, you're technically not my Twilight.
I understand. I guess spending a night with me would be considered cheating. She's very lucky.
Patience, my dear. If things follow the same pattern in this time as they do mine, then the me of this time will find you.
They reach Twilight's room. They stand outside the doorway for a moment.
Well, here we are. Again, Shadow, thank you for a lovely evening and an overall great day. Since you're probably going to be here for a few days to protect Will Atkinson, would you maybe want to accompany me to the play on Saturday night?
Shadow blushes and gives Twilight a smile.
It would be an honor.
Twilight opens the door to her hotel room. She peeks inside and notices Spike is asleep on his floor bed.
You know, Spike is asleep, Shadow, and you've had a bit too much wine tonight. I think maybe it would be best if you spent the night.
No, I know what you're trying to do, and I can't. Please, it's hard enough to resist you.
I'm sure the twilight of your time won't mind. It is still me and all.
No, this isn't fair. I miss her.
But I am her shadow. I've never experienced what you've given me today. Please, just once.
Please, I can't. You and I both know. This isn't right. We both had our share of wine tonight, and we're not in the right frame of mind. Trust me, you'll thank me tomorrow.
Twilight subtly uses her magic to telekinetically drag Shadow inside her hotel room.
What?
For someone who doesn't want to go any further, you're not putting up much of a fight, Shadow.
No, I have to go. What? You're using your magic on me!
Mm-hmm.
Twilight uses her magic to push Shadow up against the wall.
Twilight, please, I don't want to have to use my powers to free myself. Twilight!
You can't fool me, Shadow. I already know you love me. That much is obvious.
Uses magic to place Shadow in bed.
Twilight, don't pay attention to that. Eyes up here.
Hey guys! The gag reel for this episode can be seen on Queen Chica's channel. Queen Chica is now my new sound engineer, and she takes these gag reels very seriously. So I've decided to just go ahead and let her, you know, take all of our gag reels and post them on her channel as kind of like a way to draw some attention to her as well. She's a very talented voice actress on this series. As you guys well know, she voices a ton of characters. So please, please, please check out her channel and the gag reel for this episode and all the other episodes to come after this. The link for her channel is in the descriptions for this episode, so check that out. And again, guys, thank you to all of my fans and subscribers for watching this episode of Harmony and Chaos.